You're listening to the DolphinsTalk.com Podcast Network.
You're listening to DolphinsTalk.com Daily, the most listened to daily Miami Dolphins podcast on the internet. Come on, Dolphins fans. Time to fins up.
Miami's got the Dolphins, the greatest football team. We take the ball from goal to goal like no one's ever seen.
Good evening, Miami Dolphins fans. How are you today? And thank you for listening to the DolphinsTalk.com podcast on this Saturday evening, April the 29th. I am your host, Michael Leva, flying solo tonight. And the NFL draft is now over. And we have a lot to talk about in the world of the Miami Dolphins. Saturday was a bit of an uneventful day for the Dolphins. They only had two picks, and they were both very late. One in round six, one in round seven. They took wide receiver slash tight end Elijah Higgins out of Stanford at pick 197 in round six. And in round seven, they took offensive tackle Ryan Hayes out of Michigan at pick 238. So we'll talk about each one of those guys on the show, but there's so much happening right now in the world of the Dolphins from what they did Friday night and the aftermath of that with this roster, with the fan base, and everything going on. That's really kind of the lead here, and I don't want to bury the lead. But before we get to any of that, as always, a big shout-out to everyone listening and watching at finheaven.com. Everyone go to finheaven.com, the largest Miami Dolphins message board on the internet. Also, a big shout out to our friends at the I Am a Miami Dolphins Fan Facebook group run by the great Carlos Hernandez. If you're on Facebook, please be a part of the I Am a Miami Dolphins Fan Facebook group for the best Miami Dolphins information on Facebook. And also, for those of you listening on the Dolphins Talk YouTube channel, thank you as always. Be sure to smash that like button on all the videos. If you are not following us on YouTube, be sure you go to YouTube, search Dolphins Talk up there in the search bar, and subscribe to our channel. So whenever we do shows like this, you can listen to us there. But also when we do live shows, you're going to want to join us when we're on live in the chat. So you can hit the little alert bell notification as well. So when we go live, it goes straight to your smart device, and you can join us in the chat there for those of you who listen via YouTube. And one last thing, I'll just get the ad out of the way now so I don't have to do it the rest of the show. There are only 9 spots left for you to have an opportunity to throw a touchdown pass to Tyreek Hill. That's right. You can meet Tyreek Hill, throw him a touchdown pass on May 20th in South Florida. It is $2,500, but that is 100% tax deductible. It is good for you and a friend, so you can bring someone with you. The event, you'll have some FaceTime with Tyreek Hill. There's a professional photographer there who will take a picture of the moment where you're throwing Tyreek a pass, and they will blow it up to 16 by 20, and Tyreek's going to autograph it for you. Get your pictures taken with him. You get an autograph for you and Tyreek where you're throwing him a touchdown pass. There's also going to be some food there and a big barbecue. There's going to be live music there as well. So if you want to go, head to my Twitter page, at Dolphins Talk. It's the top tweet that's pinned to the top of the page. Or you can call Brandon Branch at 347-331-1323. 347-331-1323. Or email him at brandon@whipfundraising.com. Tell him you heard about it from us here at DolphinsTalk.com. So, let's get into the news. Like I said, pretty quiet day here with picks in round 6 and 7. When you're picking guys in round 6 and 7, you're just hoping to get guys that can make the 53-man roster. But in reality, the odds are these are practice squad guys this year who you hope you can coach up and develop. So a year from now in 2024, they can be on your roster as contributors or in a rotation. So that's what you're kind of hoping with the picks that they made today with Higgins and the offensive tackle there from Michigan, Hayes. But we'll see. Overall, overall, the expectations coming into this draft weekend were kind of low for the Dolphins. They only had 4 picks. They didn't have a pick in round 1. And only having 4 picks, you're kind of handcuffed in what you can and what you can't do. And I think having so little to work with, they really had no ammunition to trade up. They probably didn't want to trade any future picks next year because they're already down a pick in round three next year as a punishment for the tampering. So you really don't want to trade any more future picks. They were just going to sit tight, stay where they are, and just pick a guy round two, round three, round six, 1-7. And then next year, when you're back to almost a full slate of picks, not quite, then you can be more proactive and moving up, moving down. You got some ammunition, got some currency, they say. Draft picks are currency, and you got some currency to work with. So I think next year will be a more active draft for the Dolphins. But they had to sort of take their medicine with this one, losing the first-round pick, trading a pick for Chubb and all that stuff. Just sort of sit tight and sat in. Make the best pick possible. And I think out of the four picks, I like three of them a lot. There's one of them I'm not too crazy about. But I like three of the four picks a lot. And they also signed a bunch of undrafted free agents as well. And I will run down the list of those names later on in the show. But before we get to the picks that they made on Saturday, we still have to talk about Friday night. Because I know there's a segment of this fan base who is irate and upset that the Miami Dolphins ignored the offensive line on Friday. And in rounds two and three, they did not take an offensive lineman. I hear you. I get it. Trust me, I hear you 100%. You feel the Dolphins missed a golden opportunity to add a quality piece in round two or three to help fix this offensive line. But let me tell you the other side of this. With Chris Greer's terrible, and it is beyond terrible, track record of drafting offensive linemen, did you really want him to take someone in round two or three at guard or center or tackle? He has shown he is incapable of drafting quality offensive linemen. Now, I've said this before and I stand by it. Just because he has failed literally almost every time he's drafted an offensive lineman, that doesn't mean you should stop trying. So if he would have taken one in round two or three, I understand and I would not have been mad. Not at all. Because I get it. You got to try to fix this offensive line. Even though you've kind of whipped on every offensive line pick that you've made, you don't stop trying. But he's taking a different approach. And you should not be upset that he passed on offensive linemen in rounds two and three. Because history is not on your side. And the odds are it probably wouldn't have worked out. Let's just be honest. When things fail like 9 out of 9 times, odds are the 10th time it's going to fail. And I do feel that there are a handful of veteran, free agent, offensive tackles who are still out there who can help this team. And I fully expect Miami to sign one of those free agent, veteran, offensive tackles anytime between now and early June when, all the money from the Byron Jones contract comes off the books. And with the Dolphins, in this win-now mode, where they have spent all this money and they parted with all these picks to get all these superstars in Miami, I really don't want on-the-job training with some rookie right tackle or a rookie left guard. I would rather have a vet who might not be what he once was back in the day, but at least has NFL experience, isn't going to freeze under the spotlight of the big stage or of a big game. Give me a vet who's, 60 or 70% of what he once was over a rookie who's just learning on a job, who's going to make rookie mistakes, who might play tight in a big spot in a big moment. So I'm okay with how they're sort of addressing the offensive line at this point. What I will say with this, I wouldn't be upset with them passing on an offensive lineman Friday night in round two or three. If you want to be upset, though, about the Miami Dolphins offensive line situation, you should be upset that Chris Greer and Mike McDaniel sat on their hands from early March when free agency started till Thursday night before the draft started and did absolutely nothing regarding the offensive line. That's what you should be upset about. Don't be upset about Friday night and them, taking a shot, taking a flyer on a kid in round two or three that he might be good. Most likely, he probably won't be with our luck. No, be mad that all of March and pretty much all of April, they did nothing. Nothing at all. And in the early days of free agency, there were high-quality offensive linemen out there that would have been huge upgrades and instant impact players on this Dolphins offensive line. Again, an upgrade over Austin Jackson ain't saying much. You can put a traffic cone out there because at least people respect traffic cones. Nobody respects Austin Jackson. You can put anything else out there for Liam Eikenberg, and it would probably be an upgrade. They did nothing. So that's where I'm more mad about the free agents. Because I said, you know, the first week of free agency when Miami was signing guys like, you know, Elliott the safety or Long the linebacker, and they traded for Ramsey right before it started free agency, and they're making all these moves. Everyone's like, what are you going to do about the offensive line? What are you going to do about the offense? I was the one who said, and I stand by it, I'm not going to jump on them for not signing someone in the first 72 hours. You got to give them a week or two or three. And I saw they're still doing nothing. Outside of course, Dan Feeney. You know, they didn't do anything. And I was like, okay, let's give them to like mid-April. Let's give them to like the first night of the draft. Once they start with the draft, if they've done nothing, then it's like, guys, you just wasted a valuable time. And that's what they did. And I'm more mad about that than Friday night taking a cornerback in round two over any offensive lineman. So, yeah, like Mark, if this doesn't work out, and if this offensive line, again, hampers this team, and in 2023, they either, you know, miss the playoffs, 6 or 7 seed, losing round one, something like that, and you look back at the season, you go, well, they were pretty good on defense. You know, he played the majority of the games to offense, put up points, but man, you know, they gave up a lot of sacks, or man, they couldn't run the ball in big spots. Offensive line was a liability. You know, they get fired, and they should be, because you know, they sat there Friday night after they made their two picks and spoke to the media, and almost with like an arrogant tone, like, you know, talking to the media, you know, you guys are more concerned about offensive line and tight end than us. We're fine. It's like, really? We're supposed to have faith in you, Chris Greer, who's screwed up pretty much every offensive line pick except for Laremy Tunsil, who fell in your lap from pure luck. You screwed almost every other pick up. We're supposed to have just blind faith in you? Okay. We'll see. Hope you're right. All I'm going to say, hope you're right. Now, the other thing I know some fans are upset about, although I'm not, was the pick of cornerback Cam Smith in round two. I like the pick. I have no problem with it. If you listen to this podcast on Tuesday evening with our draft insider, Dante Colonelli, myself and him told you that this may happen on Tuesday. You know, they may take a corner in rounds two or three. So I don't know why so many people were shocked by it. You know, Smith has good size, has very good speed, and he has all the traits, you know, the height, width, the length, and all that good stuff that you want in an NFL cover corner. Yeah, he has some flaws. He's not a good tackler. He doesn't like to play the run too much. Okay, there's things to work on. He's not a perfect player, but he's a solid player. And I wasn't surprised that they drafted a corner, because I think corner's a need. And this is where I want to go next. Let's kill two narratives out there. For those, and when I say that are out there, I mean, in the world of the Dolphins, I know everyone who listens to this podcast is not on Twitter. I know everyone who listens is not on Facebook. And I know there's a segment of people who have found us who aren't on social media at all. But those platforms of social media, whether Instagram, whether it's Facebook, whether it's Twitter, whatever, you get, you know, that instant feedback from the vocal portion of your fan base. And it's good to go off, because that's kind of what, you know, the fans are thinking. It's a good little focus group. So that's when I say they, that's what I'm talking about here. And there's a lot of people, fans, and even some in the media, who say cornerback wasn't a need. And you cannot be more wrong with that statement. Was cornerback the biggest need on the team? No. But was it a need? Yes. Obviously, offensive tackle is a bigger need. Obviously, running back's a bigger need. Obviously, tight end is a bigger need. But after those three, cornerback's right there. And, you know, I know there's a segment of this fan base who think our secondary is just like loaded. Like, we're just like set. Like, we're the, you know, the Seattle Seahawks Legion of Boom from a few years ago. And I honestly don't know what those people see. Trill Williams, he went to Syracuse. I love the guy. I love Syracuse football. He's been active for one game ever. And I'm not even sure he actually played a snap in that game. He's only been active for one game ever. And the way some people on this fan base talk about him, you know, you think he's the second coming of Ronnie Lott. Nick Needham is okay to good on his best day. He's a nice player. He's a rotational cornerback, a nickel corner. He's nice, but he's coming off a major knee injury. And after this year, he might not be here. He's only got a one-year deal. Noah Igbinoghene sucks, like really, really, really bad. So we can't even count him, but he's on the team, so I have to mention him when it comes to corner. Kader Kohou was a nice surprise last year as an undrafted free agent. But let's not make more of it than it was. A nice surprise, someone who, you know, probably going to be your third or fourth or fifth corner on the team. Third might even be a stretch. He was forced into that role last year with all the injuries. He's a fourth or fifth cornerback on a team, and his ceiling is somewhat limited. And then you got guys like Justin Bethel, Tino Ellison, Keon Crossan, who are just marginal, borderline NFL players. And yes, Xavien Howard and Jalen Ramsey are outstanding corners as your two starting cornerbacks. But for them, they're even coming off down years by their standards. Still good. But by their standards, it's a down year. So, yeah, when you got Howard and Ramsey, and behind them, you got two guys who are coming off ACL injuries, and undrafted rookie who was, you know, okay, he was a nice little player last year, and then nothing else, you bet your butt in this pass-happy league, you better have a legitimate third cornerback on this team. So, yeah, adding a young blue-chip cornerback prospect on day two of the draft and round two, pretty much a top 50 pick, it's smart. And I know Joe Fan in 2023, who's a fan of the Dolphins, sitting in his little basement, you know, sitting there, and he might trust Trill Williams, Nick Needham, Kader Kohou, and think they're the second coming of this superstar secondary. But clearly that trust stays in that fan's basement. And that trust doesn't live in Miami Gardens at the headquarters of the Miami Dolphins. So, yes, cornerback, not the biggest need, but a need. Don't be upset that they took one. With that said, another narrative that's out there that I must shoot down, the second one, is that somehow Chris Greer is a great evaluator of the cornerback position. And he is so good at evaluating cornerbacks that Cam Smith really isn't even needed because Miami's secondary is just loaded with elite talent right now, that they have so much talent that Smith won't even get to play. Folks, give me a break. If Chris Greer gets an F for drafting offensive linemen, then at best he gets a D for drafting cornerbacks in his time as a general manager for the Dolphins. He has been terrible at drafting cornerbacks. And if he was so good at finding cornerback talent, then they wouldn't have needed to draft Cam Smith on Friday night. Okay? Yes, he drafted Xavien Howard. That's an A-plus move. After that, it falls off a cliff. And here's the proof. Throwing big money as a free agent to Byron Jones does not take skill or talent. Noah Igbinoghene in round one was an unmitigated disaster. It was an unneeded pick when you already had Howard and Jones on the roster. Then he trades down with the Packers, blew the pick on Noah, picks up an extra pick, which he blew that again when he drafted Solomon Kinley with it. So that whole situation is a debacle. He blew the trade down, blew the pick, and blew the pick he got in the trade down. Okay? And why the Noah one is so bad, and there's other names, I'm going to get to them real quick. Why the Noah one is so bad is because it's in round one, okay? And no general manager is expected to bat 1,000. But in round one, you at least got to get someone who can play in the games and be a contributor. An example is Charles Harris. Remember Charles Harris, the edge rusher that the Miami Dolphins drafted in round one? He never lived up to being a round one pick. But at least he played in the games. He was never inactive for games. He might not have played well. He might not have lived up to the hype. But at least he actually put on a helmet and uniform on Sundays and play. Noah Igbinoghene is so bad. He's inactive most weeks. And he contributes less than zero. So yes, that is kind of a big miss. And there's levels to this missing. You miss on Cordarius Tankersley in round three. Okay, life goes on, not the end of the world. You miss on Noah in round one. Yes, it counts more. It's a little bit different. And again, Trill Williams was cut by the Saints. Might we just sign him off the scrap heap? Kader Kohu and Nick Needham were undrafted free agents. Again, if you're so good at picking guys in the secondary, you don't need to play undrafted free agents. There's a lot of luck involved with the undrafted free agents. And the other guys he's drafted since he's been the general manager are, like I said, Cordarius Tankersley, Cornell Armstrong, Jordan Lewis. These guys all, none of them hit. Outside of Xavier Howard, he has not drafted a cornerback that hit. Now, I do think Cam Smith's going to hit, so I don't want to make this about this because I think Cam's going to play. But you got to stop saying that the Miami Dolphins are so loaded at corner that the Cam Smith pick was bad. And Chris Greer is so good at finding secondary talent that I don't understand why we even drafted Cam Smith, because we're just loaded back there at corner. We're not loaded. You got two guys coming off major ACL injuries, and Chris Greer has a horrible track record of finding cornerbacks in the draft, period. So, yes. So, I swear there's a segment of fans out there, and there's some other people who blog, who are just clapping seals and lapdogs at the end of the day, who praise every move Chris Greer makes. Oh, Chris, you're the best. You're the best, Chris. You're the best. You do nothing wrong. You just find the best cornerbacks. Outside Xavier Howard, he hasn't found one that works. Let's hope that changes with Cam Smith. And let's hope that, I think now, with Ramsey, Howard, you got Smith. We'll see if Nick Nina comes back 100% and can play significant snaps. Now you got a cornerback room. Now you got something to work with. Okay, now you got something to work with. So I just wanted to say that, because those are two narratives, that Miami didn't need a corner, which is wrong, and that Chris Greer is just so good at finding cornerbacks. You know, we didn't even need Cam Smith. We're loaded. I mean, fans of the Dolphins just hype up these players like Trill Williams. One game, never even took a snap in it. You know, Kader Kohu, okay last year, but Josh Boyer got fired for a reason, folks. The defense stunk. Let's pump the brakes on some of this stuff. And I know, like I said, some people just want to, blow smoke up his ass, Chris Greer. Never question it. If you even question anything he does, you're a hater. And don't look to poke holes in any moves he does. And blah, blah, blah. You know, folks, have some self-respect. Have some dignity, okay? You can love a team and still ask questions of it and criticize it. You know, just don't be an ass kisser. Because it's really not a good look for some of you, especially for those of you who like run blogs and just, have your own shows and stuff. It just really comes off bad. So I like the Cam Smith pick in round two. The A-Chain pick in round three I thought was, once again, very good. We needed a young running back here who's going to be more in a one-year deal. He's never going to be a running back one, but as someone in a rotation, he's perfect. And he fits the Mike McDaniel offense perfectly. The size concerns me a little, but it's up to our head coach to put him in a position to succeed. And I think if he does, A-Chain will have a lot of success here and be a nice rotational running back and a nice part of a running back by committee. He's also an elite kickoff return guy. He can help there. And he's also going to be a mismatch in the passing game because you cannot put a linebacker on him. He is too fast. So if they line him up in the slot or line him up in the backfield to run a route, there is not a linebacker who can keep up with him. There's a few safeties who could probably keep up with him. Teams are going to have to adjust for that, and it's going to be a mismatch nightmare for some teams, and it's just another chess piece and toy for Tua and McDaniel to make work on this offense. So I like it a lot. Now, let's get to the picks on Saturday. Again, picks in round 6 and 7. You hope for the best, but you really, these guys are probably going to spend year one on the practice squad unless they really show out here in camp. Pick number 6, number 197, Elijah Higgins, the wide receiver tight end from Stanford. This is probably the least favorite pick of the draft for me. Seems like he's got some ability. I just don't know. He's a big college wide receiver who has issues catching the ball. That's always a huge red flag with me. If you're a wide receiver, you got to be able to catch the ball. you can run the greatest route. You can have a ton of ability after the catch. If you don't catch the ball, none of it matters. So it's kind of like a center who has issues snapping. If you can't do the snap, nothing else matters. And I know in recent years, now, here's the deal. He's an oversized wide receiver, so they're going to try to convert him to tight end. And in recent years, Miami has tried to convert numerous players to tight end. And it never, and I mean never, works out. From Les Brown, Tanner Connor, Bryce Sterk, and Jabari Blunt. Four guys, same type of thing. Not one of them worked out. And now they're going to try it again. Now look, you want to look at the positive side. If anything, the odds are on their side that one of these guys have to work out at some point. But we'll see here with Higgins. He has the ability to run routes. He has some experience, obviously, running a sort of a wide route tree based on his time at wide receiver. So in tight end, you don't have to know that many routes. He should be able to pick that up okay. He also has the ability to be a solid run blocker in space. So that's good, because in this Miami Dolphins offense, they don't really want guys who just sort of plant and block. They want guys who can block on the move, block out in the open. And I think with this guy, he kind of fills two roles that the Dolphins lost. When they lost Trent Sherfield, the wide receiver, Miami lost their best blocking wide receiver. Trent sprung a lot of long runs last year with his down the field blocking from the wide receiver position. So you could sign up, you could sort of insert Higgins in that role to be sort of like your best blocking wide receiver. And you look at the tight end room with Smythe and Saubert. There's really not much there in the passing game. And Miami lost kind of their best weapon from tight end in the passing game, and Mike Gesicki. Higgins might be able to be, you know, their best quote-unquote pass catcher from the tight end spot. So he kind of fills two roles. He can be like a hybrid blocking wide receiver when they want to run the ball, and when they want to pass, they can line him up and kind of throw him the ball over guys like Smythe and Saubert. So I see why they like him. I totally see why they like him, and I can see why they wanted to add him. I just have my doubts, because when you're coming into the NFL, it's hard enough as it is to try to get a guy to move positions. I just have my doubts. He's never going to be a tight end one, and his ceiling is probably like a second tight end in a lot of two tight end sets, which it's fine for round six. That's kind of, if he can fill that role as a tight end two who only plays really in two tight end sets, that's cool. He'll have a job for a long time in the league. So it's round six. I can't be upset with the pick, but I just say out of all four picks, it's probably my least favorite. And I also think this is probably more of a 2024 player than more of someone who's going to help and contribute this year. Just my gut feeling with that. We'll see. But he has an opportunity here, because that tight end room right now is very thin. And I do actually think, too, the Dolphins could add another veteran tight end who's still out there on the open market. Again, is it going to be anybody great? No. But it might be someone who at least has some NFL experience and can bring some value to this veteran-laden team who might need it. So Elijah Higgins, wide receiver, tight end out of Stanford, is now a member of your Miami Dolphins. Round 7, pick 238. The offensive line position, I should say, was finally addressed, as the Miami Dolphins took Ryan Hayes, offensive tackle out of Michigan. He was a 2-year starter at Michigan at left tackle. He's very tall. He has okay technique, but here's the deal. He has short arms. Got the little T-Rex arms. And in the NFL, that probably means he's going to be moved from offensive tackle to offensive guard. And that's okay, because as we know, the Dolphins have a needed offensive guard as well. I'm sure he's going to get a shot at offensive tackle, but really his long-term future is more of an offensive guard. And he's also someone who's a little light. He's probably going to need a full year in an NFL weight room and an NFL sort of weight program, as he's only 300 pounds. And if he's going to have to move to offensive guard, or even if he's going to stay at offensive tackle, he needs to add some weight. He needs to get stronger in his base, his trunk, and he's also got to get some more upper body strength. Now, the pros and cons with him is he plays at a very high pad level, and he plays too high, so speed pass rushers just sort of can push him on his ass quickly or blow right past him. That's going to be a problem in the NFL. You can get away with that playing Rutgers, playing Purdue. You're not going to get away with that playing the Jets, the Bills, the Patriots, and every other team in the NFL. He's also been labeled as someone who's very mechanical in his pass blocking techniques. He kind of oversets and gets beat inside very easily. He is a better run blocker than he is pass blocker. Hence, a move to guard would really probably be his best move. So he needs to be coached up. And you hope a year from now in 2024, he's someone who's maybe competing with whoever the left guard is this year to supplant him. But I like this pick because there's a lot to work with here. There's a nice foundation to work with. Get him a year in an NFL weight room. Coach him up a little bit. And I think a year from now, he could be someone who is a backup offensive lineman. Maybe as a tackle. You never know. Guys with those short little arms can sometimes do it. Or he's, you know, a backup guard or of some level, maybe even competing for a starting guard spot. So Ryan Hayes, you know, went to Michigan, big school, all that. Played against the best competition there in college when you're in the Big Ten. They have a lot of quality schools. They have a lot of quality schools in the Big Ten. Not quite the SEC, but ain't far behind. So overall, excuse me, folks, my voice is shot right now. Solid pick right there for Ryan Hayes. Like that pick. And again, the four picks, I have no problem with any of the four picks. Obviously, you learn about them more as time goes on, but I think the picks and rounds 2 and 3 are going to play right away. And I think the guys in 6 and 7, you sort of put on the practice squad and hope a year from now you get something. Undrafted free agents. Now, I'm recording this at 10:30 Saturday evening. Here's the list. And for the updated list, go to our website, dolphinstalk.com. We have the updated list where every time I see that they've signed someone, I update it. It'll be updated right through Saturday night, all Sunday. And if it goes to Monday, we'll update it Monday as well. Constantly. So keep checking out the website, dolphinstalk.com. I got that one article and I just keep updating it every time someone has been announced as they're signing with the Dolphins as an undrafted free agent. Here's the names we know of as of this moment. Defensive end Mitchell, and I can't say this last name for the life of me, Aguade, out of the University of Miami from the U. Edge rusher Garrett Nelson from Nebraska. Cornerback and safety, Ethan Boner from Stanford. Linebacker, Ezekiel Vanderberg from Illinois State. Linebacker, Ezekiel Vanderberg from Illinois State. Then they sign nose tackle Brandon Peely from USC. Running back Chris Brooks from BYU. Defensive tackle Anthony Montevallo out of the University of Central Florida. Wide receiver, Daywood Davis out of Western Kentucky. Safety, Bennett Williams out of Oregon. They love their Oregon secondary players. God, the Dolphins love it. Javon Holland. They had the other guy last year. Oh, what's the other guy? The guy slipped my name. Vernon McKinley. And now they signed Bennett Williams out of Oregon. Randy Charlton, a edge rusher from Mississippi State. Offensive tackle, Jarrett Horst from Michigan State, who might be Richie Incognito 2.0. He just that type of guy. Quarterback, James Blackman out of Arkansas State. So when minicamp and rookie camp's there, and James Blackman's going to be your quarterback running the rookie camp practices. And then they also signed linebacker Aubrey Miller out of Jackson State, but he did play 3 years at Missouri. And so, yeah, I mean, I think the names that are getting the most pub, I would say, are Aubrey Miller, Jackson State. Brandon Peely from USC has a good chance because, once again, they never replaced John Jenkins. So there's that there. And I think those are probably your two guys who have the best shot there making this team. We'll see. Undrafted free agent, like I said, we'll keep updating the list every time we got some more names. Dolphins, you know, with only having four picks in this draft, have a lot of room here to add a lot of undrafted free agents. So we'll see how many more they add in the next day or so. So if you wind up here, I guess the big question is, what's next for the Dolphins? The first and second wave of free agency is over. The draft's over. You look at this team. You look at what they did this offseason. You look at where they stand today. What's next? We'll just start at offensive line because I know that's what everyone thinks. They're going to sign a veteran offensive tackle between now and training camp. I don't know if they're going to sign one next week, next month, or if they actually wait till like July or August, they're going to sign one. I would say the clubhouse leaders are between these three names. Cam Fleming, who was in last week for a visit, has ties to our new offensive line coach, Butch Berry from last year with the Broncos, Brandon Schell, who was the right tackle last year for the Dolphins, and George Font, who's got some position flexibility from either left tackle or right tackle, and he played with Seattle and most recently with the Jets. If it were me, I would go with George Font, because George Font, there's not even a competition. I mean, look, I think any one of those guys are going to beat Austin Jackson, but I think Font, you just pencil in as a starter and you slide Austin Jackson down to second string. He has been that good in the past, and I think he would make this offensive line so much better overnight. Like, Schell is what he is last year. If we sign Schell and he competes with Austin Jackson, that means we're pretty much having this offensive line stay status quo from what it was last year, which isn't good enough. Cam Fleming is okay. I would probably rank him a little bit better than Schell, but I wouldn't get excited about it either. George Font can play, and he can really play. And why I like Font is because Armstead never really plays a full season, and if he goes down and he has to miss 2-3 weeks or so, you could move George Font to left tackle, and he ain't going to miss a beat there either. And some people say he's a better left tackle than right tackle. There are stats out there that say otherwise, but that debate is pointless. He can play both at a very good level. So if it were me and I had all the power, I'd go George Font first, Brandon Schell. George Font first, Cam Fleming second, Brandon Schell third. But there are some other names out there as well. So it might not be any one of those three. But that's what I would do if it were me. And I think they will sign one of those three. I don't think they sign more than one of those three, but it's always possible. I just think one of those three. Now, Dalvin Cook. I don't want to say it's 100% dead. I'll say it's like 95% dead. Because to me, at this point, it makes zero sense. Miles Gaskin's done. After the pick of A-Chain on Friday, Miles Gaskin's got no chance of coming back. You can just throw him to the curb right now. Salvin Ahmed's in trouble because Miami uses a fullback, so you can carry less running backs because you do have a fullback on your roster. So I think right now, with A-Chain, Mostert, and Jeff Wilson as your top three running backs, are you really going to give a significant contract to Cook? Because if Cook's in the mix, then why the hell did you draft a running back in three, and why did you bring back Wilson and Mostert? Look, your top four backs are outstanding. Then you got Cook, you got A-Chain, Mostert, Wilson, but all those guys aren't going to play. I mean, if you add Cook, Jeff Wilson's never going to see the field. Because you're going to give A-Chain his snaps in certain packages. Mostert's going to get some time. I mean, it just doesn't make any sense to me. And any money not, I mean, if they didn't take A-Chain in round three, I think the Cook thing is 100% going to happen. And it still might happen. What do I know? But it just doesn't make a lot of sense. And it's not sort of passing the smell test as of right now. Prior to the draft, I was all on board thinking it was going to happen. Now I don't think it makes sense. So we'll keep an eye on it. Obviously, if they add Cook, he's a huge weapon. Upgrades the offense instantly. Is the best running back they've had since Ricky Williams. I mean, he checks all those boxes. So if they add him, there's nothing to be mad about. I just don't know if it's right now, after they added A-Chain, if it's the right allocation of resources to bring in someone like him and pay him what he's gonna need. So we'll keep an eye on that, but probably nothing's going to happen there until June. And I don't think the Vikings want to let him go. I think they're going to have to find another way to open up salary cap space at the end of the day. If a veteran nose tackle's out there at the right price, Miami's really going to have to be interested. Now, they got two of these undrafted guys here. One of them is a true nose tackle out of USC. But they're undrafted. You have no idea how they're going to do. I think they do need a veteran nose tackle behind Raekwon in the center of that line. So, and I know there's some out there, obviously, but at the right price. And the longer this goes, that price for a lot of those guys starts to come down. So we'll see if they do that. And overall, on that side of the ball, they look pretty solid on defense right now. Maybe they add another safety. Maybe they bring back Melvin Ingram if the price is right. But other than that, I think they're set. I don't think they're going to do much on that side of the ball. Like I said, maybe a nose tackle, safety, Melvin Ingram, I don't even know if he's a fit anymore, but they could have a cheap vet minimum type deal. But that's about it. The offensive side, there's more work to be done. Obviously, with the offensive line, we know they could bring in a veteran tight end, which I think they will, because I think this kid from Stanford, you hope for the best. But once again, sixth round pick, now he's got to learn a new position. I don't have a lot of hopes for this year, at least hopefully long term. So I do think offensive side, we could see a tight end. We could see an offensive lineman or two. And depending on how confident they are in Robbie Anderson, a wide receiver wouldn't stun me. Only because who's the guy last year? His name is slipping. Folks, it's been a long draft weekend. And the name's slipping my mind of the kid who they drafted last year, round four. And as soon as I look it up, I'm going to drive me crazy. The wide receiver of Eric Uzakama. Somehow he had Zeke Elliott. He's in the Z. Eric Uzakama, we don't know. Braxton Berrios was just objectively terrible last year for the Jets. So, and we know with Robbie Anderson and his off-the-field issues. Cedric Wilson will be interesting. They still have him. But I think at the end of the day, they'll sign one offensive tackle. They'll sign one veteran tight end. And that's it. We'll sign offensive tackle, one tight end, and one nose tackle. I think that's probably what we're looking at right now. And that's going to be your 2023 Miami Dolphins core. And if the kid they took in round six or seven, one of them pop up and surprise, great. If one or two of these undrafted free agents just makes the team, great. Usually see one undrafted guy sort of make the team. And they've been lucky in that role. It's a lot of luck with the undrafted free agents, but they've been somewhat lucky. So I do think one of these guys will make the team. If I had to guess, I'd probably say Aubrey Miller out of Jackson State, that linebacker. I think he has a very good chance to make this team. Just because at linebacker, they don't have a lot going on right there. One other thing I did want to mention. When the media today spoke to Chris Greer and Mike McDaniel, they asked a question, which they have to ask, because it's a smart question to ask. Have the Miami Dolphins decided to pick up the fifth-year options on either Austin Jackson or Noah Igbinoghene? And they sat there with a straight face, and God bless them for not laughing while they answered, and said, "We haven't decided yet." Folks, I will answer this question for you. There is not a snowball's chance in hell they are picking up the fifth-year option for Noah Igbinoghene or Austin Jackson. It ain't happening. They're going to, and I'm sure May 2nd, after the May 1st deadline passes, they will put out a press release saying the Miami Dolphins have declined to pick up the fifth-year option of Noah Igbinoghene and Austin Jackson. They didn't want to answer this today, so they said, "We're still considering it. We haven't decided yet." That's a nice way of saying no. There's 0.0 chance of that happening. But that was the answer they gave. Let me check here social media since I've been recording to see if I've missed anything or any news. They signed another undrafted free agent, wide receiver Chris Coleman out of Cal Poly. So they added a wide receiver from Cal Poly to the undrafted list. So that happened in the time I have been recording here on Saturday evening. So, and I'm sure, like I said, there's going to be more guys because they have a lot of spots to fill with only four draft picks. So keep checking out the website, dolphinstalk.com. I'm going to have an article up tomorrow with some draft grades on various stuff. And I know, how can you grade a draft right after it happens? Everyone does it. You just take it for what it is. And nobody's saying that this guy's going to be great and this guy's going to be terrible. It's about need, value, position compared to what other guys were out there at the time. You just take it with a grain of salt. It's fun. This is football at the end of the day. It's fun. So, yes, we're going to put out some post-draft grade content on Sunday. I will say this about the draft. Since they've started to move the draft from city to city, which I am not a fan of, I like the days of going to Radio City Music Hall, New York City every year. You're in a smaller indoor facility. The room was electric. It had juice. There was energy from pick one to the, from pick one to the very, very end. Every time there was juice and it was fun and it was electric, and the crowd was into it. You had fans from every team wearing a whole new jersey sitting side by side. You had a fan from the Eagles sitting next to a fan from the Bengals, sitting next to a fan from the Chiefs, sitting next to a fan from the Lions, and they're booing and cheering with every pick. It was like a rock and roll concert, and it was fun. They started moving it on the road to get these large crowds to make it more appealing to TV. And it's worked some years. The year it was in Nashville was great. The crowd was into it. The year it was in Philadelphia, it was great. The crowd was into it. And then there's some years, like when they were in Las Vegas, the crowd was dead. You could have heard a pin drop. The year it was in Cleveland was actually pretty good too. That was a pretty energetic crowd. But Vegas was a dead crowd, and this year in Kansas City, it was more than dead. There is just no juice at some of these drafts anymore. You got the TV people sitting like 5 miles away. You can see it in the background, the stage, and it looks like they're fairly close on TV, but they're like 5 miles away. And there's just no energy in the room. The fans, there's just no energy. And on Saturday, you got the sun beating down. You got half the people standing out in the sun. There's just no juice. And the draft has changed. And I understand things always change. And change for them means making more money and having it be more appealing to the people at home watching when you see like 60 or 100,000 people there instead of just a couple thousand. But I just miss the days when it was in Radio City Music Hall every year and there was just an energy that just burst off just came off the screen as you watched it from home that they've kind of lost. So, like, today, and it's not just that Miami had no picks in rounds 4 and 5. Like, rounds 4 and 5, I mean, that was like a church. I mean, nothing was going on. Just reading, it's just not the same. But next year, it's in Detroit. We'll see how that one goes. Like I said, some of these outside venues have been good. Cleveland, Philadelphia, Chicago was a good one. Nashville was good. But when you get some stinkers in there, like Las Vegas and now with Kansas City, that bad outweighs the ones that are good. So we'll see what Detroit holds for next year. And I do want to close the show by just saying thank you. I know the draft process is a long one. We did a bunch of shows, myself and Tom had a show last night as we did more of an in-the-moment reaction to the Cam Smith and Devon Achane. The shows I did leading up to the draft with Dante Colonelli. We had the shows with Kevin Dern, who's really good and knows this stuff like the back of his hand. And also Josh and Aaron had their little preview show. For those of you who have been following all of our shows, reading our stuff up on the site, thank you so much. For those of you who want more information on our 4 picks, go to the website dolphinstalk.com. I have profile pages on Cam Smith, on Achane, on Higgins, and on Haynes here, who we took today. You can watch a ton of videos on them. You can read all the scout reviews on them, with the strengths, with the weaknesses from 4 or 5 locations. So if you want to learn more about any of our picks, go there. And again, the list of undrafted rookies will be updated all throughout Saturday night, all throughout Sunday as well. Thank you all for listening. Please be sure to follow us on Twitter at Dolphins Talk. Follow us on Instagram at Dolphins Talk. And wherever you're listening to this podcast, whether it's Podbean, Apple Podcasts, Spotify, wherever, subscribe to that channel. So whenever a new show drops and a new show goes live, you are notified on your smart device. We have more shows this week. I have at least 2. I'm doing a show with Biggie, Ian Berger, later this week. And I'm doing a show with Dante Colonelli as we go really in-depth on the 4 picks Miami made and these undrafted rookies. And I'm sure there might be a few more surprises in there as well. So thank you all who have been following us this offseason, who have maybe found us this offseason. For all the old listeners who have been with us for years, we thank you for your consistent and constant support and who have always been with us. And if you just found us recently, welcome to the club. We're a fun family who cover the Miami Dolphins year-round, and we have a lot of fun, but we also give it to you straight. We don't spin. We're not the clapping seals who everything they do is great, and we're not the lapdog who's just always going to look at the owner, oh, you're the best. Everything we give it to you straight. We love this team, but we give it to you straight. We say when it's good. We say when it's bad, and we sort of, we are the podcast where you're going to learn something sometimes. And I like how we've grown as a family here, and we will continue to bring you some of the best coverage regarding the Miami Dolphins. So thank you for all of us who've stuck with us for many years and who continue to stick with us moving forward. Now, everyone have a great Saturday night. Have a great Sunday. We'll talk to you again after a while. And folks, don't forget, let's put an end to highway profanity.
Thank you for listening to the DolphinsTalk.com podcast. Be sure to visit DolphinsTalk.com every day for all of your latest Miami Dolphins news.